In order to become fully committed followers of Jesus, we need to know two things. We need to know who Jesus is, and we need to know what Jesus requires of us. So those are the two questions we will answer. Who is Jesus, or who is this person we're supposed to follow? And what does Jesus require of us, or what does it mean to follow him? Let's start with the first question. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" First of all, Jesus asks his disciples this question along the way. He doesn't bring them into a synagogue and fire up the worship band and preach an emotionally powerful sermon and get them in a frenzied state of excitement. He asks them this question as they are walking and carrying on with their daily activities. Jesus asks us this question as we drive to work, as we do the dishes, as we shop for groceries. Jesus comes to us in the mundane, normal activities of life, because it is in the mundane, normal activities of life that we prove our love for Jesus.
Jesus asks his disciples, "But who do you say I am?" Jesus shifts the attention away from other people toward the disciples. It was time for them to make a decision. What other people say about Jesus doesn't really matter all that much. "Who do you say I am?" Peter, being the bold, confident person that he was, says, "You are the Christ." The Jews assumed that the Messiah would be a spiritual and political king who would reestablish the nation of Israel. The Messiah would take out all of Israel's enemies and establish political and spiritual peace once again. This is who Peter and the disciples wanted Jesus to be. And we are discovering that Jesus is not always who we want him to be, but he is always who we need him to be. We can ask God for something, but sometimes the answer is no. In this case, we should not be angry or upset with God, but feel confident that he has something else in mind. When our daughter had her twins, they were very sick. They were very severely premature. In particular, Nicholas had many health issues with tubes going in everywhere. We prayed for his recovery, that he would make it, but he didn't. Sadly, he passed away, and we were devastated. However, his little sister did survive, but became blind as a result of her prematurity. Needless to say, Kiara needs are a challenge, and had Nicholas lived, his challenges would have been even greater.
He began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected. Rejected by the elders, the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again. And he said this plainly. This is the introduction to Jesus as the suffering servant. Jesus would undergo three things. He would suffer many things, be rejected by the elders, and be killed. He came not to be served, but to serve. To take up your cross means pursuing God's mission for you, not worrying about someone else's mission. We can easily spend our whole life watching other people live their mission while we fail to live out our own mission. We can concern ourselves with a million things that don't matter and fail to do the things that do matter. That is why the imagery of bearing the cross is so important. The image of carrying the cross is meant to say this: you now have a mission. You have been claimed by someone else. You don't have time to worry about what other people are doing. You must do what Jesus is calling you to do.
Taking up your cross and following Jesus means allowing for more messiness in your life. Now, don't take that the wrong way. I think you still should sweep your floor and mop the floor on occasion. But if you pursue a mission in your life, you're going to make a mess. Take building a house, for example. That can be an ugly, dirty, messy process. Things are going to look awfully ugly before they look good. We need to be careful not to replace mission with the goal of having a nice, clean, put-together life. That's not the goal of the Christian. The goal of the Christian is to pursue the mission God has given us. Missions cause messes. No mess, no mission.
What is the goal of our church? The mission of the church is not to keep a nice, ordered, clean, and comfortable church. The mission of the church is to make disciples, and this will and should be a messy process. It was for Jesus, and it will be for us, because we are all messy, imperfect people learning to be disciples of Jesus. Amen, and God bless you.